Hi everyone, the next section we are going to talk about is realism. Realism takes place in American literature between 1865 and 1890. After the Civil War and toward the end of the 19th century, America experienced significant changes. With the closing of the Western frontier and increasing urbanization and industrialization, and with the completion of the first transcontinental railroad and the advent of new communication technologies such as telegraph, America began to emerge as a more unified nation as it has moved into the industrial age. That was one heck of a sentence. Look over here at this picture. This is the Transcontinental Railroad being built. Isn't that cool? That looks so neat to me. I love old pictures. Also during this time period, we have a rise of the immigrant and middle class as immigration from both Europe and Asia peaked during the last half of the 19th century. Immigrants provided cheap labor to rising urban centers in Northeast and eventually in the Midwest. Here's a neat little picture. This is a rooftop garden at Ellis Island. And then there was a subsequent rise in the middle class for the first time in America as the economic landscape of the country began to change. The country's social, political, and cultural landscape began to change as well. So a lot is going on in America. Also, we have a lot of social movements. Women began to argue for the right to vote, to own property, and to earn their own living. And simultaneously, African Americans also began to rise to social and political prominence. They called for social equality and the right to vote as well. If social movement is something that interests you, I always find it fascinating to read about how the rise of women and social rights and the right to vote, how they always sort of coincide with the African American struggle as well. So those two struggles rise together. I find that interesting. Also, workers in factories and businesses began to lobby for better working conditions, organizing to create unions. Free public schools opened throughout the nation, and by the turn of the century, the majority of children in the United States attended school, which was something that didn't often occur because, you know, people lived on farms. You didn't necessarily need to understand the reading, writing, and arithmetic if you just needed to, you know, farm. So I thought this was really interesting. Next, throughout the latter part of the 19th century, activists and reformers worked to battle injustice and social ills. Within this heady mix of political, economic, social, and cultural change, American writers began to look more to contemporary society and social issues for their writing material, rather than to the distant or fictional past. So as people are moving into close quarters, they're moving into cities, they're beginning to deal closely with other humans, you know, literature changes, our story changes as a nation. The first members of the new generation of writers for American Lit are American writers. These guys wanted to stay away from mimicking the old British writers and incorporating British literary customs into their works. But these writers did look to the older American writers, and those are Nathaniel Hawthorne. Of course, here he is. He wrote The Scarlet Letter. If you've heard of Hawthorne, you've probably heard of The Scarlet Letter. And then we have James Fenimore Cooper here. And these guys reacted against their predecessors' allegiance to the romantic style of writing, which favored the ideal over the real representation of life in fiction. So rather than look to British authors as mentors, they looked at Hawthorne and Cooper. However, they did want to stray a bit from their style and change things from romantic to realism, to be more realistic about what our life looks like as Americans during the industrial age. We look at these three guys as our sort of grandfathers of American literature. We have William Dean Howells here, Mark Twain, and then of course we have Henry James here. Each of these wrote in the genre of realism, but they each had their own style. We will do Howells and we will do Twain and we will do James. So we will do all three. So you'll be able to experience those guys and the differences. Realism of everyday life. When an author would choose to write in the realistic mode, they tended to commit to a referential narrative. Their readers expected to meet characters that resembled ordinary people, people that looked just like their next door neighbors. Often these characters were in middle class, living in ordinary circumstances, who experienced plausible real life struggles, characters that the reader could identify with. Realists tended to develop these characters by using ordinary speech and dialogue, and sometimes she would comment on the character's social class or the social hierarchy. Often in realistic stories, characterization and plot became intertwined as the plot was formed from the exploration of a character working through or reacting to a particular issue or struggle. Characters in realistic fiction were three-dimensional, and their inner lives were often revealed through an objective, omniscient narrator. And an omniscient narrator is also an all-knowing narrator, so they can see inside the mind of every character. They know what that character is thinking. So that's interesting. So basically, in this realistic mode, the character would drive the plot. Three things that we need to look at. Realists set their fiction in places that actually existed. That's the first thing that's important. We don't see trips to Narnia or the Shire or any of those imaginary places. They're set in places that actually exist. So it tends to be limited to a particular place or region. Second, realists believe in the accuracy of detail. Accuracy helped the author to write truthfully. Finally, realistic writers believe that the function of the author is to show, not simply tell. The story should be allowed to tell itself with a decided lack of authorial intrusion. I think we'll see that when we read William Dean Howells' Editha. So just kind of keep that tucked in the back of your head. Realistic writers attempted to avoid sentimentality or any kind of force or heavy-handed emotional pill. These stories are not sappy. They're not over-emotional. These stories are to the point. And incredibly, I think a lot of readers can see themselves in the characters, that they would react the same as the characters. They're not that sort of romantic, fainting at the sight of things. So, the three most prominent theorists and practitioners of American literary realism are Twain, Howells, and Henry James. And I like it here because they say that Mark Twain is the comic realist, Howells is the social realist, and Henry James is the psychological realist. So sometimes Mark Twain is also known as the regional realist because of Huck Finn and sort of that Mississippi, the region of Mississippi. So kind of interesting. Now, when we talk about realism, we have two offshoots of realism. We have local color, and then we have the regionalism that I was just talking about with Mark Twain. So it's sort of splintered local color. This tends, after the Civil War, people became really interested in the more isolated geographical locations in America, and people wanted stories about eccentric, kind of goofy country folk or folk that lived out in the West and, you know, had wild shootouts. So local color became very, very popular. The writer, typically was concerned with habits, customs, religious practices, dress, fashion, food, dialect, all of the things that made that particular location special or different. Most of these stories involve a stranger who comes into this little faraway town out in the middle of nowhere, and how the stranger typically thinks that he's more intelligent or savvy or whatever than the local folk. And then somehow the local folk really stick it to him. So in local color stories about the South, for example, we have Mark Twain's The Jumping Frog of Calaveras County. And in this story, we see how a individual and a outsider thinks that he's going to come into the little town and outwit all of the locals. Local color writing can be seen as a transitional type of writing that took American literature even further away from the romantic style and more firmly into the realistic style. So whenever you see local color, you generally see a lot of cussing, a lot of swearing. You'll have a lot of regional dialect, common things that happen in a day, silliness, just common human foibles. So local color. Regionalism differs because it is seen as a more sophisticated form of local color, because typically what happens is the author will use one main character, a protagonist, and this protagonist will offer a specific point of view in the story. You will see elements of local color in regionalism. It's part of it. However, regionalist writers tell the story emphatically from one protagonist's perspective. So they attempt to render a convincing surface of a particular time and place. However, they do investigate the psychological aspects of the character, and they do that from a more universal perspective. So you kind of have an outsider's view of the protagonist. Within regionalism, your characters tend to be more three-dimensional, whereas in local color, they tend to be a little more stereotypical. And often what regional writers, from squarely falling into the category of realists, is that they tend toward nostalgia. You see a bit of sentimentality, authorial intrusion, or a rather contrived or happy ending. So if you feel good after you leave the story, it quite possibly is regionalism. Regionalism is often used as a term to describe many works by women, along with the right women as they began to fight for the right to vote, to own property, to the rise of female authors also coincided with that. And this happened during this time period. We have here Sarah Orne Jewett. She wrote The White Heron. And then here we have Mary Wilkins Freeman. She wrote The New England Nun. I really enjoy that story. But both of these ladies tended to write within the region of New England. And also the women in their stories tended to be, to crave independence, to want freedom. On the other hand, we have Kate Chopin here. She was predominantly from the Louisiana bio region. She was very interesting. She wrote The Awakening, The Storm, The Story of an Hour. She was very independent. She was very, she perhaps was the most openly feminist of these writers. She was banned quite often. Her books were banned, and she was, you know, she took a lot from her writing for just sort of the empowerment of women, and that women didn't need to be married to be happy or be independent of themselves. Here we have Charlotte Perkins Gilman. She too is often lumped into this category, and she wrote The Yellow Wallpaper, and she sort of explored the more psychological elements of being a woman and what type of psychological toll that could take within a patriarchal society. So she's often tapped into this realism category as well. So, you know, it helps us frame the timeline that these women wrote in. However, you know, it does kind of reduce them when these women were the very beginning of female authors in America. So I find these guys interesting. We'll cover several of them as we go through the chapters, but that's just a quick introduction to realism, 1865 through 1890.